Hello, I'm the Reverend Ruth Vann, Lillian. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Bay County. We are a covenantal community founded on loving kindness and a common devotion to our free faith. We recognize all the earth as sacred ground, and we welcome each other into this space. We especially welcome those of you who are visiting with us today. We are so glad that you are here after our service. We'll gather outside. It'll be a great time to talk with folk about the fellowship.
Please join me now in a call and response reciting of our covenant. Love is the spirit of this fellowship. And service is this way. This is our covenant. To dwell together in peace.
Well, I can't do it.
To seek the truth and love. To promote a sustainable world and to help one another.
Our opening words are by Unitarian minister, teacher, preacher, Theodore Parker. Be ours a religion which, like sunshine, goes everywhere. Its temple, all space. Its shrine, the good heart. Its creed, all truth. Its ritual, works of love. Its profession of faith, divine living. Matt and I are going to sing our opening hymn. And while we are not singing as a congregation yet, you are welcome to hum behind your mask.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to do some announcements. Ken and Susie Sizemore, they still continue to need help. I'm going to bring a special attention to a link in the e-news from Joe Schaefer to a home delivery meal schedule that was set up by Janet Cross. This will provide a way for people to know who's bringing meals. That's going to be for a couple times a week for Ken and Susie. Please ask or go to the email from Joe Schaefer to get the link. And the next couple services, on November 21st, next week, Alicia Simmons, a local actress and comedian, will be giving a presentation focused on her journey through the pain of losing her family at the age of 12 to becoming the person and comedian she is today. November 28th, Reverend Ruth will deliver a pre-recorded service entitled, "Is that a hole or a skylight?" Life is full of problems, from small inconveniences to major disasters and losses. How can we maintain our optimism and hold on to hope without trivializing suffering? Do we patch the hole in the roof or turn it into a skylight? Other news, Morgan Horn of Rainbow Trim is going to be coming here to do some repairs and some painting. She might be here for maybe for a couple weeks, maybe even 3 weeks, because there's a bit to be done. So anyways, if you see Rainbow around here, I mean Rainbow, if you see Morgan around here, give her a hello. Thanksgiving with UU friends. We will host a UU Thanksgiving dinner here at the Fellowship on Thanksgiving Day, Thursday, November 25th at 3 o'clock. Hopefully the weather will be pleasant and we will be eating outside. The UU will provide the turkey and non-alcoholic drinks. And we do need a volunteer to cook the bird. There will be a sign-up sheet at the entry table. Please let us know how many in your party and what you will be bringing. We will be looking for potatoes, stuffing, vegetables, salads, breads, desserts, your favorite Thanksgiving dish. If you decide that you want to come at the last minute, that will be okay also. I said that there'll be no, that we are not providing alcoholic drinks. If you'd like to bring wine to have with your dinner, you are certainly welcome to have that. Joys and concerns. We take this time to reflect on our joys and concerns and acknowledge our mutual support. If you would like to share a joy or sorrow, please come forward and speak into the mic, so those that are watching online will be able to hear and see you. Would anybody?
Well, I have a minor sorrow, which is that I wasn't here last week to see your presentation, but mostly I have this enormous joy. I went to St. Louis to visit with my family this last week, and we did our annual, almost annual, last year they missed it, apple butter making, which is a huge event. I have 9 brothers and sisters, and we were all there with my mother. We have fantastic pictures. There were probably 45 to 50 of us, including 4 generations, right? Because my mother made, 4 generations. We had such a wonderful time sitting outdoors with this fire underneath, this cauldron of applesauce turning itself into apple butter with the aid of people with this huge paddle. I mean, it's I mean, I can't describe it. I have pictures, but that you push back and forth over the bottom of the pots, right, to make apple butter with, and everybody is required to push this pattern so that we can say it is the Jamborette family apple butter, right? There you go. Anyway, it was a blast, and seeing my family and my mother was just wonderful. So I missed you, but not that much.
Anyone else? Thank you for that, Chris. Ruth will lead us in a meditation.
As we consider the joys and concerns of our friends and neighbors, let us spend a few moments together in silence. Just to be is a blessing. Just to live is holy. In this moment, on this day, at this time, in this sharing of space made sacred by our awareness, let us remember the blessed gift of life, which we all share, and let us pay attention to one another so that we may enrich one another through our intrinsic holiness. Just to be is a blessing. Just to live is holy. May we remember and bring renewal to our community and our world. Amen. Shalom. Blessed be. The offering is a sacrament of the free church. It is supported by the voluntary generosity of all who join with us. The offering will now be given and received in grateful appreciation of our shared hopes and values. Thank you. The boar's head, as I understand, is the rarest dish in all the land, which thus bedecked with a gay garland, let us servire cantico, caput apri de ferro, red ends loud as domino. From age 5 until my mid-20s, Christmas was inextricably linked to the Boar's Head and Yule Log Festival, performed every December at my home church, Highlands United Methodist at 5 Point South in Birmingham, Alabama. It required over 200 volunteers and the amazing direction of Linda Shepherd for its lifespan of over 30 years. The church was always filled to overflowing, and the huge Mediterranean-style dome glowed within and without. I started out with the little children in red and green jingle bell trimmed outfits, carrying a lantern behind Father Christmas. By the time my brother Michael was jingling with his lantern, I had graduated to turban-topped torchbearer in the king's procession right behind my father in the role of Melchior, singing over his incense. In high school, I became a page with a green cape and carried a bowl of fruit. And by college, I had joined the choir to sing all the glorious music. Deck the halls, good King Wenceslas, here we come a-wassailing. Let all mortal flesh keep silence. Oh, come all ye faithful, the Boar's Head Carol. It was magical, and my holiday would not have felt quite right without it. The word holiday means literally holy day. The origins of most holidays lie in religious traditions and the setting aside of a day or days as holy, with required observances involving what folk eat, how they dress, and religious rituals for home and community. Now, I know such words are problematic for some Unitarian Universalists, for whom such traditions may bring painful memories, or have simply left behind the trappings of the theistic traditions they once observed. Some of us are suspicious of anything which smacks of the supernatural or involve religious practice upon which one's eternal well-being might depend. But other words come to mind: sacred, consecrated, sanctified, venerated, revered, blessed. While traditionally the idea of holiness has been connected to a divine being, it also has value apart from such belief. I imagine all of us have been in places which felt holy somehow, or had experiences which seemed sacred, or have objects in our possession which we revere to some degree. I have walked through, prayed, and sung in a number of cathedrals around the world. I've also joined Sabbath services in Jewish synagogues. I once attended a worship service in a Buddhist temple and a special feast service in a Hindu home. There were significant differences among these places and practices, but I recognized the holy in all of them. When we make something holy, we set it apart from the regular or mundane. We draw special attention to it, and often we invite others to witness the holiness. Think of a wedding or memorial service you have attended where candles were lit, songs were sung, and carefully measured words were spoken, all to consecrate the ritual as special or revered. Sometimes the holiness just happens without our making any special effort. Picture the ocean bathed in the light of the sunset, or the view of mist rising off of a succession of hills, or the quiet of mother and father and newborn babe all asleep in the hospital room, or two lovers entwined in their bed together. Well, you understand. The holiness of a thing or a space or an event may be more or less obvious depending on us. Are we paying attention? Not all our national and cultural holidays are holy days, but holiness may be found or created in any of them. Thanksgiving seems to be largely about eating and traveling. It is loosely connected to the autumn harvest, but for many of us, that is not something we experience firsthand. There are reunions, gatherings, and the renewal of relationships, which are all worthy of reverence. There are many festivals having to do with the end of the year, the dying of the light, and the hope of a new and better time ahead. And some are wrapped up with powerful myths and stories of religious observance. Advent, Christmas, Epiphany, Samhain, and winter solstice. Hanukkah is a celebration of a divine miracle in a particular story from Jewish history. And Kwanzaa is a holiday for the strengthening of African American culture and community. New Year's Eve and New Year's Day are secular holidays acknowledging the ending and beginning of annual cycles. Jewish theologian and philosopher Abraham Joshua Heschel said, "The road to the sacred leads through the secular." There are plenty of purists in every religious community who resist the mingling of the sacred and secular, but unless we retreat from the world to engage in spiritual practice, and a few still do, we must at least endure the one to find the other. Rather than spending energy complaining about the commercialization of the holy days, whichever holy days you may observe, it may make more sense to sort through the secular elements in the same way we might sort out our closets to prepare for the holidays. What in the secular celebration is useful or meaningful to you? As a practitioner of Advent and Christmas, I seek music and theater to enliven my imagination and stir my soul. I need a bit of Scrooge and the Grinch, some Jimmy Stewart and Bing Crosby alongside my candlelit carols. While one-horse open sleighs are mighty scarce in Alabama and Florida, I will joyfully jingle a few bells before the season ends. We plan to put up a real tree again this year, as we have every year of my life and my children's lives. We will dig out the Christmas boxes, and son Liam and I will decorate with beautiful, tasteful ornaments right alongside simple items made by all of us when we were children, and some rather tacky ones that just remind us of absent loved ones who decorated trees long ago. Last year, a family member was in the hospital all through the holiday season, and we didn't have Christmas Day at home until January 6th. The only lights we could find that worked were aquamarine, Who knows what the tree will look like this year? For us, the holiness is in the process of decorating, wrapping, cooking, tearing presents open, eating the meal made sacred in our togetherness, warmed by the awareness of beloved ghosts of Christmas past all around us. What is holy to you? What is sacred? The expression sacred ground is very old. In the ancient Jewish text, the story goes that Moses was out tending sheep and saw something strange up the mountainside. He went to investigate and found a bush burning hot. He realized that the burning did not decrease, that the branches were not consumed by the flames. When he tried to move closer, he heard a voice that told him he must remove his shoes because it was sacred ground. Many cultures require the removal of shoes before entering the space set apart for worship, like the Buddhist temple I mentioned earlier. Why? What do shoes have to do with sacred space? Well, our shoes sometimes walk through dirty places. And in many sacred spaces, people sit down on the floor. They bend over and place their faces there. They allow their children to lie down there also. It is more hygienic to remove shoes. But that is just a surface concern. Understanding the holy is about awareness. Removing our shoes is a call to extend our awareness. What makes any ground sacred? Who walked there before? Who was born there? Who died? Whose bones or ashes are scattered there? Was sacred work accomplished in that spot? Dave Carter wrote a marvelous song some years ago called The Gentle Arms of Eden. It is a celebration of the evolution of life on our planet, and it's a prayer to the creatrix to help us before it is too late. The chorus declares, "This is my home. It is my only home. It is the only sacred ground that I have ever known. And if I stray in the dark night alone, rock me, goddess, in the gentle arms of Eden." If any ground is sacred, then all ground is sacred. If any food is blessed, then all food is blessed. If any baby conceived under strange circumstances and born in an unexpected place far from home is holy, then all babies. All babies are holy, and all children, and all adolescents, and all adults, and everyone everywhere. The holidays, commercialized as they are, chaotic and crazy as they make our lives, are pointing at a great truth. Holiness is everywhere. All around us, under every footstep, under and around every tree and blade of grass, in every place, from the most grand to the most humble. Holidays, each of them, the ones we are familiar with and the ones we've never heard of, are reminding us of the truth that each of us is a holy vessel of the extraordinary and splendid gift of life. The greeting and parting gesture used commonly in India, hands clasped in a prayerful attitude and tilted toward the other along with a nod of the head, called namaste, is both a mundane greeting and a religious ritual of acknowledging the sacred in each person. Namaste means I bow to you, and also the divine in me bows to the divine in you. It is a way to honor the holy within both ourselves and each other. Pick a holiday and pay attention. You will find the holy if you look and listen carefully, Remember these words from Rabbi Heschel. Just to be is a blessing. Just to live is holy. Namaste. Amen. Shalom. Blessed be.
We extinguish this chalice, we extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Siblings and kindred, go from this place and be aware of the holy everywhere that you go. Just to live is holy. Namaste. Go in peace.
Your way, moonlight star.